Welcome back to Julia, Among the Stars. Okay, I think I have it. So I just started out by following the blueprint as closely as possible, but cutting off the obviously unnecessary uses of tiles. So for example, like right here where it goes up two, and then over, and then down. I just shortened it from what would have been something like this, and I just shortened it down here. And that's pretty much the only way that I obviously save space. Oh, also here. So here it went out one, and then it started going down, but here I just went out one and just instantly started going down. So I saved space in a couple of ways, but it wasn't quite enough, as you can see. I'm missing two pieces here, but I think I just figured it out. So if I actually change this to be like that, that gives me exactly two pieces. So I think I have it. Let's try it. Oh dear God, please work. Come on, come on, come on, come on.
That's it.
Yes!
I did it!
Yay! No upgrades available. I love the voice. I love the way that she says that. Like, that's it! I did it! Like, she's so proud of herself. Okay, that's the second... Is that the second thing I've constructed? It is, isn't it? Yeah, it is. Alright, well, we have one of four upgrades installed into Mobot, the portable analyzer. I can only guess as to its function. Perhaps analyzing things in a portable fashion. I don't actually know why I needed to make that, though. I kind of forgot. I kind of completely forgot. I kind of forgot what I was doing. We just left Xenophon, right? Yeah, now we're at Xenobia, which I believe is somewhere that we previously landed on. Not while I was playing, but didn't they explore this planet? Yeah, it looks like there's one landable place now. Okay. It's an oceanic world that's 99% covered by water. While Xenobia is slightly bigger than Earth, it is located directly in the habitable zone of the Salia solar system. One day on the planet lasts a little less than 18 hours, and with an absence of orbiting celestial bodies, it will be interesting to study tidal forces. Waterworld. Okay, can I actually leave this place back to solar system? I actually can. Like, can I just go to whatever planet I want? Apparently you can, wow. I guess I can just try to keep scanning if I wanted to, but let's just stay at one place. Well, actually, let's not. Let's actually go back to Xenophon. Warp drive! And the reason I want to go back here... Just skip that. Yep. Is because I have not finished with my mind-o-matic thing. So I'm gonna keep working at this and see if I can get it completed. I did some quick looking online and it looks like if you finish all of this correctly, something actually does happen. I think it's just like an achievement that pops up. So it's nothing big, but it does actually confirm that you have it correct. So it does actually give you some feedback. So yeah, I'm gonna work at this and see if I can get it completed. Aha, there we go, I think. Yep. I think. That did say success, right? I can't move them out? Yep, I can't move them. Okay, there we go, I got it all connected. Alright, There's one unexpected thing about this, but let's just run over the whole thing. So let's go from the beginning to the end. And by the way, I managed to construct this by looking at every single data pad, and basically I just wrote down on a piece of paper all of the dates. And then I just read every single data pad, and for that date I looked at what everybody said were the major events of that day, And I also looked at the analyzed data about the laser gun and the bodies and stuff like that. So, let's run through it. It was on the 23rd that the crew landed on Xenophon. It was on the 24th, which is not pictured here, that the first symptoms started appearing, although I believe one person, I think it was Andrew Lark, actually said that the crew started feeling weird on the 23rd, which is when they landed, but everybody else seems to say it was on the 24th, the day after, that they started feeling the symptoms. And then it was on the 25th that, I believe it was Andrew Lark, first discovered that the communication with the probe was completely dead. They couldn't communicate with it. And then I believe Barth found out from Andrew that this had happened. It was on the 26th, which is not pictured here, that they sent up some samples to the probe, or... Wait, if they sent up samples to the probe, but they had no communication with the probe, how could it return negative? Huh. Okay, there's something weird there. I thought on the 26th they sent up samples to the probe to see whether there was radiation and it reported negative. But if it stopped responding on... Does that mean Andrew Lark lied about the fact that there's no radiation here? Maybe I've just misunderstood something, but maybe that means they never even asked, actually, they never actually got readings from the probe about whether there was radiation. But surely they would have done that before they landed, right? And it reported back negative for that? Yeah, I mean, you wouldn't go into a place that could have radiation and then send up samples to see whether you're safe or whether, hey, we're all screwed. I guess we shouldn't have come here in the first place. That doesn't make any sense. That's weird. Anyway, it was on the 27th that Lai Zhang died from radiation poisoning. She was the first. It was on the 29th, which is not pictured here, that Andrew Lark blamed Cynthia for the poisonings. It was on the 30th that Alex Hinckley died from radiation poisoning. He was the second one to die. It was on the 31st that Andrew Lark killed Cynthia. So on the 33rd that Barth made the Geiger counter from by destroying the hovercraft and using its parts. It was on the 36th that Barth discovered the excessive radiation. He already suspected it, of course, that's why he went to make the Geiger counter from the hovercraft, but that's when he confirmed it. And then it was the day after, on the 37th, that Barth actually died from radiation poisoning. And then, kind of all in the same time, Andrew Lark shot Pavel in the back of the head when he was sleeping. Or was it just in the back? I don't remember if it was in the back of the head or just the back. But yeah, he shot him while he was sleeping. He also shot Scott White, who I believe he sent out to look around the perimeter. And then he also shot himself. And that's the part that surprised me. He shot himself. Because I thought... If we go back here... Ooh, hold on. Let's confirm whether he was actually shot in the back of the head. Or let's not. Actually, we can't look at it again. Hold on. Analyzer. It's you? His skull was fractured by a strong blast. Okay, yeah, so he was shot in the head. But yeah, if we go back here, we know that this is Andrew Lark and he was killed by a laser blast. And interestingly, if you look at the laser gun, it says the fingerprints overwhelmingly match Andrew Lark, but there's traces of Scott White's fingerprints. So Scott touched the weapon. That's why I thought, you know, given that we haven't found, we can't confirm exactly how Scott died, I was thinking, perhaps Scott maybe shot Andrew. Andrew tried to kill Scott. Scott maybe took his weapon from him and then shot him. I mean, why are his fingerprints on the weapon? I don't know, but evidently, according to this, Andrew Lark shot himself. So there we go. That is the official story of what happened here. There's another interesting thing, too, and it's in the last entry in Andrew Lark's logs. This. So she planned this from the beginning. I am going to end this madness tonight. I will send Scott to patrol the perimeter and deal with him later. As for Pavel, it will be better if he is asleep. Our expedition has failed. So that's when he shot Scott and Pavel and then himself. All at the same time. But who is this she? Is he talking about Julia? she planned this from the beginning? I'm gonna end this madness tonight? I actually don't think these are related. She planned this from the beginning, I'm gonna end this madness tonight. I don't think he means he's going to end her madness. I mean, there's no one left alive that is even a her. I think he's talking about Julia. But Julia planned this? Why would she plan this? Why would she want this to happen? Assuming that's talking about Julia. But I'm also curious why he killed everyone. Why? He shot Pavel, and he shot Scott, and then he shot himself. What, is it just to end their suffering? Or was there something else? It's not like they asked to be killed, though. So, that's a bit strange. It doesn't seem like a mercy killing. But why would he shoot them? So she planned this from the beginning, so he obviously knows that neither Scott nor Pavel is in any way responsible. Maybe he just cracked. From what everyone else was saying, it sounded like he had gone a bit crazy, a bit off the deep end. I don't know. Also, by the way, it occurred to me, when I was reading through these logs, somewhere it mentions Rachel. I think it was Scott's databad, right? Cynthia told me about Rachel. Let's see. Yeah, here we go. Spent the night with Cynthia again. She was talking about her childhood and about Rachel. I don't understand why Rachel was cryo-jailed either, and ironically, she'd be the only one who could get us out of here. You know, when I originally read that, I don't think I realized Rachel is me. I am Rachel Manners. Which is kind of funny. And I suppose that's kind of a side effect of the fact that you are interacting with this game through a lot of menus, rather than kind of playing from your character's viewpoint, which I guess means you do kind of run into that problem, don't you, where you're kind of divorced from your character. Because I forgot that I'm Rachel Manners. But yeah, I'm Rachel. I mean, that's gotta be the same Rachel, right? Unless there's two Rachels? Doubtful. And I did wake up out of sleep. 60 years asleep. So apparently I was cryo-jailed. Now I'd like to know why Rachel didn't say, "Hey, Julia!" I mean, given that she's the one that's reading this log, right? How come she didn't say, "Hey, Julia, why did you cryo-jail me for 60 years? Could you please answer that? Thank you." It's a bit strange. You'd think you'd be a bit miffed about that, wouldn't you? I was cryo-jailed. It's extremely suspicious. Okay, this place is officially done. Leave. There's the leave button. The leavening. The baking powder. Can I really go to any of these planets? I guess you can. I'm assuming these are all places we've explored. Ambrosia? Yeah, I remember. That was one of the places. Elpis? That doesn't sound familiar. And it's got a Mun! I'd love to go to the Mun. If only I could build a spacecraft that doesn't explode coming out of the atmosphere. Okay, so which one should I go to first? Does it matter? Can I go to any? I mean, this is where I was gonna go. I guess I'll just go here. Alright, to the water world! Hopefully it's got all of the water and none of the Kevin Costner? Was that who was in Waterworld? I'm not quite sure. Oh, pretty!
This is so beautiful. Xenobia must be the cradle of life for the entire solar system. Is it possible that it's real water?
I think so. I will get a sample for you when we get closer.
I love this place so much. It's undisturbed even by our crew.
Opaque crystals. They look like some sort of a food, but I forgot the name of the food, so now that kind of just ruined that joke. What the hell's it? Oh, now I remember the name of it. But now it's ruined, so I'm not going to tell you. Sorry. This is beautiful.
Rachel, you'll find this interesting. Those plants are emitting vapors similar to the gas ring around Xenobia.
Are you telling me that those little buggers are responsible?
I am not certain, but the similarity is striking.
Mobot, take a sample, please.
I'll get that for you.
So I just constructed a mobile analyzer, right? So I can, yeah, I can just do it right here. Cool. You know, I wonder if I didn't make the mobile analyzer, could I just go all the way back to the other planet and just analyze the samples there? Living organisms, resembling plants, that are actually millions of swarming small insect-like creatures. When gathered together, they form regular plant-like shapes as a result of their hive behavior. They also produce gas vapors of the same consistency as the Xenobia ring, and despite the improbability, they might be the source of that ring.
Those crystals must be ancient. I wonder how they were formed.
Based upon the surroundings, I would rule out magmatic processes.
I think you're right. The most likely source is precipitation from this ocean.
How do you get rectangular precipitation? You know, I wonder how different actual real-world scientists would find games like this. Like, say, a geologist. You know, how would a geologist look at this? What would they see? Would they find it incredibly cool? Or maybe if the science isn't done very well, maybe they would find obvious flaws and holes in it, and maybe they'd actually like it less? I don't know.
After all the time spent in probe, I'm finally on vacation.
Allow me to inform you that you're technically still in the probe.
Oh, shut up. This blue sky is so Earth-like.
Still, don't you think the vapor ring around Xenobia makes it look really alien?
I wonder what Earth looked like in times when there was just water and nothing else.
Maybe we've traveled back in time and this is just an early version of Earth. That's incredibly stupid.
Mobot, can you get me a specimen of this coral? I'd like to analyze it.
Affirmative.
Analysis reveals that the corals are similar to their Earth counterparts, and are formed by colonies of invertebrates originally washed away by the ocean. Further analysis would be necessary to discover the exact details of these life forms. I think we have to go somewhere now. Let's go here.
Interruption. I am detecting a peculiar phenomenon.
What is it, Mobot?
My internal spectral analysis reveals some sort of a periodic signal.
Let me check it.
Hmm?
You are right. There is some sort of interference. We need to isolate that frequency.
Minigame?
Can we do a fast Fourier analysis of the signal?
We need better audio equipment for Mobot.
So if we upgrade Mobot's audio, we can find out what the signal is?
If you manage to find and build the upgrade.
How am I... How am I supposed to just find an upgrade? Like... How... That... What? That's not how science works, or... I don't even know if you'd say that's science. That's not how anything works. You don't just find the upgrade. That makes so little sense. Just like, oh, we just dropped the upgrade here. It was under this coffee cup. Just load it in. There we go. Yeah, get that floppy disk in there. Like, what? Wouldn't everything be upgraded as much as it can be already? Like, before the trip even started? Before we even came to Xenobia or any of these planets? You know, you get the equipment you need, and then you take that all with you and use it? Like, what? Unless we've been away for so long that we've actually advanced our entire state of understanding and improved all of our equipment. I don't think so. I can press a button to enjoy the vista. I don't need to do that. I can just enjoy it without clicking anything.
This place is magical. So calm and soothing.
Yes, even I sense the tranquility. I wonder why my circuits respond to this place so strangely.
Maybe it's your first time by the sea.
I must say, I have experienced vista before, and I did not enjoy it.
I already took a sample.
Yes, yes, yes.
These crystals...
This has got to be very tricky to navigate around, actually. Even for Mobot, the terrain is very lumpy and irregular. Descend. Into the water? Probably just right up to the water.
Allow me to inform you that I was not built for underwater operations.
Are you kidding me? J.U.L.I.A told me that you can survive in extreme conditions.
Mobot is right. Unless we upgrade him for underwater operations, we can't risk doing this.
Damn.
That's gonna be a thing, isn't it? I'd love to go underwater. So there's no point at looking at any of these, right?
These crystals...
Nope.
I already...
Oh my god. Why didn't he get rid of those hotspots since I already looked at them? I don't think I can actually do anything here without more upgrades. Yeah, to the peaks. And I can just go back down. Down here. And then... Yeah, that's it, actually. Alright, I think we need to visit another planet. Because I don't have any more upgrades, right? No. Mystery signal. It's like our goal. Yep. Okay, where should I go next? I have heard a lot of stuff about Ambrosia, and apparently stuff going wrong there. And isn't that the planet where someone died? Actually, apparently a lot of people have died, so it's probably true for every planet. Was this Ambrosia? No, that wasn't it. There it is. So let's check this out. Let's give it a scan. Ambrosia, which apparently means immortal, is a rocky planet with a vast vegetation belt on the equator. It's also the very first exoplanet with directly observable extraterrestrial life. Of particular interest is a massive purple spot on the surface, which appears artificial and invites a closer inspection. A single day on Ambrosia lasts 27 hours. Massive purple spot. Oh, there's the massive purple spot. Artificial. I'm assuming we examined it. One landable place. Let's go check it out. I'd love to see some alien life forms.
Wow, this is entirely unexpected. That jungle definitely seemed to be inhabited.
Can you hear me up there? This place is quite disorienting for my directional sensors.
We can hear you loud and clear, Mobot.
Very good. Can you provide me with any additional visual guidance?
It depends on what we want to do here. We should definitely search for evidence of the expedition.
Okay, let's explore the jungle to see what we can find.
As you wish, Rachel. I'm activating the advanced visual map guide. Unfortunately, this place can't be mapped from above, so we have to rely on the auto-mapping feature. On the other hand, as soon as we map any important spots, I can automatically guide Mobot there without your further assistance. Simply click on the point of interest, and Mobot will go there instantly.
Is the auto-mapping feature ready?
Indeed. As soon as Mobot exits this landing zone, I'll make it accessible to you.
Thank you, Julia.
Okay, so in other words, planet big, therefore fast travel? This place is beautiful. There's gotta be so much life here. Yeah, forests like these are filled with an incredible amount of biodiversity.
This tree baffles me.
How so?
Look closely at the leaves. They're growing in thick clusters directly from the trunk. Even though the tree has lots of space for growth, it doesn't create branches.
Well, maybe it just likes to keep to itself. It's a considerate, shy tree.
Julia, do you know what I find the most surprising here?
Tell me.
This vegetation. It looks so similar to plants on Earth. Of course, I don't recognize any of these plants, but we're so far from home and plants look like plants. Rocks look like rocks, and it's even raining here.
Pardon my interruption, but I am detecting a faint trace of a very corrosive acid in the rain.
That's odd. Does it mean that the plants are resistant to it, or is this the reason why some of the plants look so withered?
Some of them do look withered now that you point that out. The trees look fine. But these don't look too good. The stuff on the ground does look a little bit yellowed. Whoa. What was that sound? What the hell was that sound? It sounded like something, like, snuffling. There it was again. Hello? I wonder if that's that cat-like creature, which I believe was found on Ambrosia, right? Alright, only one way to go. Oh. Jungle navigation. Your keys are buttons to navigate through the map. Okay, sure. Alright. Interesting, so we have kind of a tile-based system.
Have you been to this jungle before?
Indeed. And it was quite a disaster.
Was the crew attacked?
Well, I prefer the term greeted, but the crew thought otherwise. They answered with gunfire.
How terrible!
Yes. Unfortunately, all those years of training for first contact were ignored in the realities of the jungle. The crew's fear of the unknown was too strong, and they did not even try to make contact.
You're saying they fired on sight?
Yes.
I doubt mankind ever learns. Buried deep in the jungle, with no sight of civilization and strange beings all around, they must have been so afraid. I don't think I can judge them. Do you know who was down there?
According to my recovered memory files, Andrew Lark led this expedition.
Again, Andrew takes the lead. Maybe his experiences as a soldier in the 2217 Middle Eastern War contributed to his paranoia down there.
Fired on sight. Well, that would explain what I had heard about Andrew Lark, and how I believe at least one person said that he kind of messed up the mission on Ambrosia, and that perhaps he was trying to cover it up or make up for it or something like that. And given that this does seem to be primarily a scientific expedition, that does seem like a major, major failing to freaking fire on sight, my god. Alright, so how does this work exactly? And this is back here. Oh, you have to press these buttons. You can't just click. Oh, I see. Okay. That's interesting. Still hearing something around here. So I guess I can use the arrow keys too. Yeah, I'll just use the arrow keys. Much easier. So I can't actually click on any of these things, I guess, until I find a campsite or something like that. A site of interest. Don't see anything of particular interest yet. All looks pretty much the same. Lots of strange trees and vegetation.
Wow, This can't just be a coincidence.
No, this structure was created by sentient beings.
This place is so tranquil, yet surreal at the same time. Almost mystical.
It's beautiful. It's a swirling hole.
What the heck?
I am detecting a strong energy field.
Can you analyze what kind of energy it is?
It clearly has some electromagnetic properties, but I am still not sure what it is.
Is it dangerous for your circuits?
I don't think so. More likely, my sensors are not sensitive enough to understand the true nature of this energy.
This really isn't a natural formation, right?
No. Someone has built it.
Look at that flora! It looks neither alive nor dead, as if it were attracted towards that swirling spot. Maybe there is some kind of symbiosis keeping it alive.
Feeding off of its energy? Somehow? Maybe?
I apologize, but I am unable to tell you more about this strange energy.
Okay, so judging by the fact that I can still examine it, I'm guessing I need to either do something with it at some point, or maybe I can upgrade Mobot's sensors to be able to actually see what's going on with it. Insect. Oh. I didn't even see that.
Just look at this! That insect almost looks like a firefly. Let's catch it and learn more about it.
I would like to know how Mobot just caught that bug. He doesn't seem well equipped for grabbing small objects. This insect shares a few common features with Coleoptera. Coleoptera? Yeah, Coleoptera. Their eyes are noteworthy because the insect perceives an entirely different spectrum resulting in their ability to visualize environmental sounds. The glow is caused by a phosphorus-based chemical compound excreted by the insect. Interesting. So sound-based navigation.
This tree looks hollow and dead. Let's check it out.
The tree has been completely consumed by millions of tiny insectoids. Upon closer examination, it's literally moving by incredible swarms of these insects. It's impossible to find out how the tree manages to stay alive. Literally moving by? Do you mean moving with? Swarming with? That's a weird sentence. Let's go ahead and head back. Let's go forwards here. Thank you. I feel like I'm about to be attacked. We're getting like the creature cam. Oh yeah. Yep, creature cam camera angles.
I am being approached by a local life form.
Stay calm, Mobot. Let's try not to repeat history.
Hello?
Oh my goodness, no wonder the crew panicked. I'm glad I wasn't there. I don't know how I would have reacted.
I think that it's trying to communicate with me, but I cannot understand what it is saying.
Try to greet him and show him that we come in peace.
Creature pauses for a moment in thought. Suddenly, it starts drawing mysterious symbols, as if wanting you to read them.
It seems they have a written language. I might have more luck analyzing it instead of their native speech.
Another minigame! Okay. Let's see what's going on. What did I just do? I should probably click this. Translate the symbol or symbols. symbols below by clicking on all the upper words in a matching cluster. I think this is another case where the explanation is probably going to be very confusing to me, but actually just doing it is probably going to be not too hard. Cluster is defined by the number of output connections. That makes no sense to me. I'm going to click on stuff and watch stuff happen. I have no idea what I'm doing. What? Apparently I just translated something. I'm just clicking random stuff. I don't know. Yay! Progress? Oh no, I think I just messed up the translation, didn't I? Has it regressed? Progress? No. Oh, it's redoing the whole thing, isn't it? I have no idea what's happening. I'm gonna read the instructions again, I'll be right back. Okay. With absolutely no thanks to this, once again, very, very hard to understand explanation for an actually incredibly simple concept, I have figured out what you're supposed to actually be doing. So, stuff up above is what you click, stuff down below is what you're trying to match. Thing down below has three connections, right? 1, 2, 3. You have to click on whatever up above also has three connections. So for example, this has 1, so that's not it. This has 2, that's not it. This one has 3, just like this does. That's the one. And that's it. Like, does anyone else find these explanations for all these minigames incredibly hard to understand? The games themselves are not that hard to understand, they're all quite simple, but the explanations just do not click with me at all. I don't know why. It's weird. So this one has 2, this has 3, this has 2, there we go. 2... 3... If I mess up 1, I think I'm going to go all the way back to 0%, which would be very, very sad. 3... 1... I'm not actually paying attention to what these are actually saying, so hopefully there's a summary at the end. New language successfully learned! Please do not hurt me, you who came from the skies. God, if only a new language is that easy to learn. I did in like a minute. The creature has raised 2 of his limbs in the air, crossing them. As his eyes gradually change to a magenta color, it appears to be surrendering. Oh no. Have we scarred them that much that they instantly want to surrender to us?
Don't worry, we come in peace.
I'm but a humble servant of my lords. I've always obeyed the ways of the ancients. Have you
Let's
returned to punish us again?
We have no clue about that incident, right?
Tell him that we're here to learn about the ways of the ancients.
Is that so? We welcome you to our home. If you indeed seek the ways of the ancients, you must help us answer the questions we have for many revolves.
Analysis. By revolve, it probably means the planets orbit around their sun, which we would perceive as their year.
Explore our home at your leisure, and meet me again by the gates of our settlement. And then the creature vanished from view. Obviously, they have mastered the art of natural camouflage.
Are you kidding me? Unless there are more advanced life forms than the one we've met, it sheds an entirely different light on them. This must be a statue. And to think that an extraterrestrial life species produced this art.
Don't get carried away too much. You have no idea how they actually perceive this. I would be deeply surprised if they would share any kind of common view with humans.
You're right. It's just so similar in a sense. I would have expected something different. Everything should be different.
That is wonderful. Look at that. It's even a painting on it. Alright, what's gone in my goals? Oh, the alien reunion. I have to find three critical places relevant to history of Ambrosians and then meet him at his settlement. Okay. This game is much larger than I thought. Much, much larger. I was assuming this game would be maybe like 3 hours long or something, but it's looking like it might be more like 8. I mean, it seems I can visit all of these planets. And it seems like you have to go to certain planets to probably find upgrades and then go back to the other planets to then use those upgrades. Like going back to the water planet, once I can actually go underwater. Yeah, there's actually a lot more to this than I thought. Alright, well, I'm gonna end this episode here. So, I hope you've enjoyed so far, and I'll be back soon.